Good evening. Welcome to today's webinar, Career Insights, Debt Capital Markets in India, hosted by CFA Institute and CFA Society India. I would like to take a moment to welcome our audience from around the world joining us remotely. I'm Rajendra Kalur, CFA, Independent Management Consultant, and also a member of the board of CFA Society India, looking after Research and Advocacy Committee. Before I introduce our speaker, I have a couple of housekeeping notes. Today's webinar is scheduled for 60 minutes, including question and answers. 45 minutes presentation by the speaker and last 15 minutes devoted to questions, answering the audience questions. Please feel free to submit your questions throughout the presentation. You can do so by clicking on the Q&A link at the bottom of your viewer and typing your question in the box. This webinar presentation will be available to view after the presentation concludes in the chat box. We value your feedback, so please complete the evaluation survey before you sign off today. Now it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker for today's webinar, Jayan Shah. Jayan Shah, CFA, co-founder Mavuka Capital Advisors, which uniquely serves its clients' needs from strategic and management consulting to capital, both equity and debt mobilization. In its short but very impressive history, Mavuka has successfully executed 8 transactions, totaling more than 13.3 billion INR. Shah has worked in various organizations in his career spanning nearly 25 years, including organizations like IDFC Bank, IDFC Limited, Standard Chartered Bank, Royal Bank of Scotland, Rabo India Finance, ABN AMRO Bank, and Kotak Mahindra. At IDFC, Shah was the key architect behind the India Bondhouse Award for 2015, awarded by IFR Asia, and Asia's Best Local Currency Bond Deal for 2016, awarded by IFR Asia and Global Capital Asia Money. Shah's expertise encompasses fixed income, credit markets, financial and capital markets, capital financial structuring, bank capital securities, and financial advisory services. Shah, apart from a CFA charter holder, holds a master's degree in management studies and finance from NMIMS. Over to you, Jayan, and I look forward to your insights for today's presentation.
Thank you, Raj. Thank you, CFA Institute. And good morning, good afternoon, or good evening to all my friends who have joined on this call from whichever time zone that you are currently in right now. And before I get into the depths of debt market, let me share a small trivia or small update about our moderator Raj himself. So I wear a t-shirt, which is thanks to Raj in the sense that Raj last year was on a cycling expedition, which was unique in the CFA Society's activities. And he went on to for several days, he along with several other CFA charter holders or CFA members, institute members as well, on take the financial knowledge, awareness, literacy to villages across western part of India. And that was quite an achievement, quite a feat. Raj, you are quite a motivator yourself.
Thank you.
Sorry, is my screen up and visible to everybody?
Yep, Jayan, I think it's visible to me, so it's visible to everyone, I guess. Yeah.
Thank you. So I can say, friends, that I'm indebted to debt for life. When I say that, I mean debt markets. Given that my life career started in 95 in the fixed income team of Kotak Mahindra, that 3 years at Kotak Mahindra was starting from when the market itself was opening up in private placement in India for bonds. During that journey of 3 years, we had RBI giving certain relaxation to bank treasuries to participate in private sector corporate bonds, and which to my mind was one of the key regulatory inducement for opening up the private placement market and what we see today, private placement of bond markets. Those years were when the 10-year government security of India was yielding more than 14%. AAA bonds were running around at 16-17% itself. So from there to where we are right now, it's quite a journey. And I would try my best to share with you various aspects of this bond market's development in India, more precisely and more insightfully, about how friends on the call, on the webinar here, can make a career out of debt markets India or debt markets other places of the world. Kotak Mahindra, from 98, I went on to join ABN AMRO. And then, as Raj already mentioned, moved across various organizations. But the playfield and the tools and the, one may borrow the phrase, the arms and ammunition and the, you know, the ammunition that I gathered were applicable in various roles, various things. So whether that was in form of finding a financing solution for a client, whether that financing solution was borrowing through markets, through bonds, through securitization, onshore, offshore. So various products are visible depending on the needs of the client. And of course, various end users of the funds that are being considered. Had the chance, had the ability to work on a variety of structuring elements beyond the cash market products into the derivative market across asset classes. Structured notes globally and structured derivatives in India, and if people recollect in 2004, 5, 6, 7, and some part of 8, before the financial crisis hit the world, was quite a rage. Of course, all this also required a fair bit of understanding of the borrower profile, whether they are in the corporate domain or they are in a financial institutional framework like a bank or NBFC and so on. That was a fairly intense learning. And specifically last 7 years, or rather 2011 onwards, the infra financing has been a fairly detailed, insightful, and at times hair-pulling learning as well. And anybody who has been in the infra finance, project finance, will probably relate to this as well, that how difficult, how challenges are thrown up in the financing world that seem to be never ending. Yes, been part of the journey of variety of inwards and reads that came to the light of in Indian environment. All this was always possible, visible when we had clients or I had clients to face off. Clients are demanding, clients help build up your own personal education. Clients motivate you. And clients are actually finally, as put in by many friends, many people philosophically, because of clients, you exist or you survive. Let me take a shot of what I'll cover through this next 40 minutes, 45 minutes, including the landscape, what all are players in and around the entire infra providers, the organogram that is applicable in variety of organizations, and careers that are shaping up in variety of forms and ways. And variety of competences that we're built on to ensure that our careers in debt markets are truly rewarding. As I said, I'm indebted to debt for life, but not personal leverage. I meant the debt markets. Let me take a pause on this particular screen, which all of us have probably related to or heard in our childhood, the sixth blind man and the elephant. The story is always has to be in our back of our minds, that get the big picture, understand the big picture. What is the overall framework? Where does the pipe start? Where does it end? So this is a reminder to me day in, day out to get the big picture in. And let me take a moment to share with you what I firmly believe what is all debt market all about. Any form of capital which is non-dilutive, non-equitative, part of the balance sheet, is either mezzanine capital or is a debt capital. Mezzanine, hybrid, structured, variety of generic names have been used to this, but a non-equity is what part large players or many players prefer it to play around debt markets, debt capital markets. Markets, what are markets? Markets are something where the requirer or the person, corporate, needing funds, needing capital, goes out to and reaches out to the provider of capitals. The provider of capital could be a local institution, could be international investor, could be a retail participant. So we have providers of capital where a market provides a free access to both sides in some form or shape. Important is, of course, the pricing dimension. A market provides a pricing discovery in an unbiased format, and it's dynamic. It takes into its calculations variety of moving components, moving parts. And of course, it also permits risk management tools to address certain risks that one brings on in your balance sheet or in your fund as an investor. The form of borrowing, the form of capital could be further distinguished in a security format, whether they are in bonds, debentures, notes, government securities, or they are in a loan format, or they are in a other working capital format. Securitization structures, security receipts, they're all part of a wider definition of a debt market or debt capital market, including subordinate debt or mezzanine debt. Let me take a shot at giving a 30,000 feet view of a market landscape. As I said in the beginning, sometime back, we need, of course, the two main components are the providers of capital and the firms, the type of agencies that require capital. This leads to a certain segmentation for easier way of describing them. Of course, regulators at the top of the pyramid, which provide continuous guidance, guidelines in ensuring an orderly market framework. Regulators, there are investor side regulators, there are borrower side regulators, and so on. RBI, SEBI, IRDA, PFRDA, EPFO, so on. And one expands this market landscape to include a global landscape of the debt markets, then there are regulators in various other geographies, various other domains. They provide, as we all know, the necessary guidelines for infra players to provide their services. Infra players are depositories, central counterparty, information agencies, Bloomberg, Reuters, other information agencies, exchanges. A lot of things are traded on the exchange. There are a whole host of things which are not on the exchange and which are on the OTC format. A necessary role played by credit rating agencies, the trusteeship businesses, or security agents, bringing the borrower and investor together is a role largely by the DCM or debt capital market units, investment bankers, brokerage houses. There's a role, there's a need for every box on this slide. And careers are built starting at one box, going to the other box, and moving around the entire ecosystem. Careers are built in a single organization, careers are built across organizations, across types of roles, or across types of investor bodies. Careers are built in variety of ways and forms, and I'll try my best to give certain insights as to how careers are built and what all professionals like ourselves can learn, earn, respect, gain full employment, and so on from this market. I just mentioned about variety of infra players which are there in the ecosystem to help the market thrive, to help borrowers of capital reach out to lenders and providers of capital, and not only borrowers in the primary instance, but also in the secondary instance, as in the secondary trading markets, where change of hands can happen. Even if one may not want to trade the holding per se, but may want to manage risk on it. Therein, variety of players come in, variety of agencies come in. Again, leading to the fact that careers and are there in every aspect, building up for variety of professionals like yourselves, listening to this call, listening to this webinar, to take some of my experiences and insights, if I may be of any help. If one were to look at the slide, and I kind of tried to look around as to how different organizations are built, how does an organization structure evolve? Somebody sent me this and I thought it is, don't get perturbed with this slide. And I have no personal interest to put Amazon, Google on this slide, but just to bring the nuance out of it, that org structures and therefore the career definitions that drilled in are sometimes based on how and what institution we are part of, or that part of our journey in the debt markets. I'll try and give a sense of how a sell-side organization is typically built. And why I say a sell-side organization is the one which is an investment banker or debt capital market unit, whichever name one gives it, starting from the roles that are there. You know, one would have to have a product team that either directly, indirectly through his other corporate bankers or other formats, reach out to the shops, the houses, the firms that require capital. So product origination team, whatever name that may be called in different organizations, will also have a unit which is working on variety of regulatory aspects to ensure that things are done as per regulation, as per legal compliance requirements and documentation are done before actually any kind of transaction is led to the market for raising capital in the debt form. As I said earlier, there are nuances based on product itself, whether it's a loan, whether it's a bond, whether it's a securitization. So all that gets captured between a larger product origination role or a product role, along with a corporate finance or a documentation team that feeds each other. Variety of organizations have what is called the underwriting and internal structuring. This unit or this kind of a function will spend time dissecting the borrower's financial numbers, projections, end use of funding, what are and where are the various risks associated with it, to make it comfortable for an investor or in-house underwriting committee's approvals, investment committee's approvals. So this is at times independent and probably needs a little unbiased perspective rather than fit with origination world. But it is a necessary function. The point here is that it's a function that is necessary and it is built into a variety of large shops, as this function will work alongside with the underwriting team or investment committees in the organization or at the buy side organization, where they will be able to translate and share with their, for the particular case that is to be raised money for. Then various organizations have dedicated sales units, and this is a more India, as I said, it's an India type of organogram. The sales units, syndication units, are typically the loan syndication function, which will on an ongoing basis take the transaction over to their profile of co-lenders and so on. Sales function, which is a fixed income sales team, bond sales team, called reaching out to a variety of investors in that particular type of investor bodies. While I explained that underwriting by itself is an independent function than sales or origination, and that is actually one of the key requirements where shops or houses, and I refer to my own, some of the houses that I spend time, a length of time, where underwriting is an important mandate winning criteria. Along with that comes responsibility and accountability, because a borrower would finally wait for the underwriter to honor the commitments irrespective of how it is received by the marketplace, as in by the investor community, or not received. So underwriting unit also needs help from the trading unit, aftermarket, market making on those instruments. Many places have trading units sitting in a treasury function or a separate trading. But wherever they sit, there are roles out there. And this unit also will need access to risk management, internal acceptance of the framework, and the tools that they can execute the risk management requirements. So that typically is the shape of an organization structure in a credit market unit. And more of this, or most of this, will be present in a local franchise. A broking franchise will probably have a lot more hands that might be reaching out to, instead of the origination function, might be reaching out to the existing traders or holders of those securities or those loans. And on the other side, keeping in touch with a variety of buy side investors. So that is where a broking function might be a little different than the DCM function. But more of that, I would at this juncture also share with you as to how those functions evolve as one moves from a local landscape to a global landscape or a global DCM platform. A global DCM platform will necessarily have a large presence in a research team, research of macro rates and credit, a strategist team, a syndicate group. A trading group may be different than a syndicate group. And sales could be far super specialized based on geography, based on type of products, whether they are rates, government bonds, large multilateral bonds, or they are credit sales. Or they could be also defined based on what type of investor body the sales team is reaching out on a day-to-day basis to close, to work on their functional KRAs. Similarly, origination machinery could be divided across product type, a separate origination machinery for loans, for dollar bonds, for euro bonds, for domestic currency bonds, for private placement market versus public issue markets, and so on. So product type could have an origination machinery further subdivided, because they would focus on that kind of borrower types and build in both the product skills as well as the credit skills or understanding skills of that particular types. A funding desk, a repo, structured notes, and so on, which will fund the positions that the global DCM shop is running on, and a treasury risk management team, which will provide not only the risk approvals on ongoing risk positions of monitoring that, but also counterparty risk and so on. The reason to share all this is clearly to highlight that as one deep dives, there are a variety of functions and roles that are there in a capital, in a debt capital markets. And a lot of friends, a lot of names that you may have heard started in a particular geography, has gone across to other geographies or into a larger role in London or larger role in Singapore and so on. No learning is unimportant. Switching gears or switching tracks from a sell side to a buy side, from an investment banking kind of a framework to a fixed income fund management framework. I'm sure a lot of you may have relate with this, who are in the investment management arms. The fund managers are product or term dependent or term divided. Short-term products, money market, liquid funds, rate products, government bond funds, or funds which are very closely mimicking the rate products or rate curves. Credit as a separate asset class is in itself a big asset class. So a separate fund management arm or unit in the credit space, they may be supported by a significant arm which is working on transaction, structuring, documentation related activities, and so on, or maybe also associated with credit research from that perspective, or corporate research, both at times of primary participation and or subsequent trading on it and monitoring on it. A product development team, as we have seen in last many years, the world is constantly evolving, and thankfully in Indian environment as well, there are many more products getting built up. Products could be in public space like a mutual fund, or could be in a private space like an AIF. A product development team could work across this space. A product could be dedicated towards a certain market a certain target markets, whether onshore or offshore. And apart from them, apart from all the other boxes, there could be specific dealers or traders who are keeping in touch with more dynamic events and activities happening in the marketplace, and they are on the screen looking at prices, looking at tactical moves, who's coming in, who's buying, who's selling, and they would have access probably to cash products, to derivative products, and so on. I happen to take a little help from my daughter, and she kind of did a Google search on the fixed income and just came up with so many names under which fixed income roles were getting publicized. Whether they are a fixed income macro analyst or a credit strategy or a business analyst, and roles popped up, like 20 plus roles popped up on a Google search. I did a similar exercise on LinkedIn a few days back, and numbers popped up. Roles publicized under debt capital markets in last month, or publicized under fixed income, and 798 roles were publicized or requirements publicized. So friends, there's a whole out requirement out there in the marketplace if one was to see debt markets in its entirety. Let me summarize at this point as to how and what are key points in a buy side or a sell side. Sell side, probably there are many more roles, many more functions. A sell side teams are larger. They are covering an ongoing basis of much wider variety of people. And because it's client intensive, it's intensive, engagement intensive. So the number of people required may be larger. And I tend to believe that there are many more people in a sell side franchise. Their key performance metrics could be volume generation, could be new deals, could be revenue generation, innovative deals in, or could be even monitoring and getting the right kind of underwriting going. It is a fair bit of both technical and client awareness, technical skills to the level of, and there's no stoppage of learning. So technical skills need to be constantly sharpened. A good measure of awareness about regulation. Specific functions might require a much deeper awareness of regulation, compliance, Companies Act, legal framework, drafting the trustee document, ensuring all things are ticked. Because finally, the sell side franchise are, if they're not underwriting with hard dollars, but they're definitely underwriting with their reputation. And world is VUCA, very dynamic. We are continuously seeing volatility, uncertainty, and ambiguity. So sell side roles probably have much larger number of bodies, number of professionals required. buy side also has a lot of ongoing requirement, and as we see regulations getting evolved, more buy side roles are likely to come up, and rightly so. As we have seen variety of new learnings that came to us in 2017-18 after one crisis after another, in at least in Indian context. And this buy side roles are embedded not only in specific franchise which are just buy side players like a mutual fund or an insurance company, which the large role is manage money, or pension fund managers, but also they're embedded within a primary dealer or a corporate treasury, or they're embedded within banks trading departments. As I said in one of those earlier slides, banks DCM departments. So there could be buy side roles even in a trading units. If we were to look at the borrower as a community, now for many borrowers, many borrowers or borrower conglomerates, there are a lot of specialization that they want to continue to bring in and continue to develop on, because fundraising, capital raising is right center part of their function. And if one speaks about enterprises like infrastructure or enterprises which are into infra elements, then fundraising is a very, very regular activity. An ongoing corporate, which is capital intensive, a fundraising is a very, very regular activity. So there are corporate treasuries which have roles kind of resource raising or resources or treasury. Maybe the same roles also, you know, crossover into managing money on hand in the balance sheet, in the surpluses on short-term basis or long-term basis. These roles necessarily will work within a set out principle of ALM or set out principle of risk management, alongside key metrics measurements such as optimization of cost, maintaining a certain level of liquidity at all points in time, and so on. So these are the key metrics that they typically need to be bothered about or need to be mindful of. At least in local context, and I would believe, and I tend to have that from a credit perspective, rating agencies play a very, very deep role. And as we all know, the regulations are fairly evolved over the last many years, that it is now almost necessary for any kind of borrowing, whether we are doing in a bond form or in a securitization format, some form or shape, we need rating on hand. And hence, rating agencies play a very, very critical role, and there are many roles, industry focus roles, rating side roles, or structured finance roles, wherein a rating agency, rating teams help in a wide variety of building on to the product, building onto their rating and monitoring them. So there are large roles out there, many roles out there under rating agencies as well. And some of the skills that are required, apart from the research or analysis, forecasting and structuring. Further on, taking a moment again back on the borrower, and specifically mentioning about the NBFCs, housing finance companies, the microfinance institutions, where it's a raw material for them. A manufacturing unit has a different set of raw materials, but NBFCs, financial institutions, money is the raw material. And that is what they need to bring in every day and then deploy that as per their charter, as per their philosophy. So it's a core function. And all of you will probably agree with me that in last two and a half years, it's become extra core function in the NBFC environment. Herein, of course, a key element is keeping track of what are the evolving regulations, how one is compliant, how one interfaces with not only the investors at ongoing basis, but also with the rating agencies at an ongoing basis. So that perspective is very critical, and that functional learning is important to gather and maintain. Banks also need a wide variety of capital and capital securities, whether they are AT1, whether they are tier 2 bonds, or long-term infra bonds, which were permitted by RBI in India to open up and raise funding under. A lot of institutions, banks, through their offshore branches or otherwise, have raised funds through offshore markets. So fundraising in offshore markets is a key element, both at corporate level as well as banks, masala bonds, newer things are being opened up. So we have a variety of things for banks to worry about, and there are specialized roles over there. Let me try and bring on table certain emerging categories that are there, wherein roles have been visible, are seen, and some of my friends have joined them over the last many years in PE funds, in sovereign fund, wealth management funds or venture funds, where while fundraising in debt format may not be possible under regulations in the Indian context for many of those emerging investor categories, but they would have skills to either manage treasury of their portfolio companies or investment companies, both manage money on a macro level or their resources, as well as manage risk from their those shops, from their portfolio companies. But if one were to be moving from a local world to an international world, then many of these PE funds and sovereign wealth funds have specialized teams sitting in their global centers, managing fundraising in a non-equity format for their own funds, and which they are permitted to do based on their jurisdictions or their regulations. Similarly, extending on the newer emerging categories of investors, specific AIFs in credit funds, debt funds, private wealth management arms also have functions or teams focusing on debt through their investment advisory units. Venture debt, as the name sounds, is specialized debt funds for emerging ecosystem players, startup ecosystem players. Family offices are diversifying and putting money into a variety of asset classes, which are credit oriented, and stress asset funds, growing trends out there. Market infrastructure that I spoke about in a market landscape, roles are there across variety of these valuation firms that provide valuation services, dedicated research firms, investment firms, investment and advisory and risk management firms, and so on. And we have consulting companies. They require debt management, debt market skills, transaction advisory skills, Big Four, and so on. A friend of mine, Jayesh, at JurisCorp, he's a CFA charter holder himself, started JurisCorp, a legal counsel, does a variety of things. But the point is, a flourishing career built in under debt market skills or debt skills in legal counsel as well. Bloomberg, Reuters, they are continuously expanding on their functionalities, on their tools. They require in-house skills to collaborate with the users and bring out new tools. Fintechs, I'll speak about it a minute later. All of you who are on the CFA journey, all of you who are CFA charter holders and other friends who have joined in, CFA course is a strong foundation, provides a huge, usually strong technical ingredients across variety of subjects that we study in the 3-year intense course. Macro to corporate accounts, accounting standards, risk management, benchmarking, valuation, mathematics, starting from bond mathematics to option mathematics, all kinds of product knowledge. India is in some sense somewhere behind on the path where global study leads us to, but nothing at all is wasted. All of that comes in some form or shape in our day-to-day journey, in my day-to-day lives. Couple that, add that with a necessary bend of mind to read regulations, to read law, at least understand them, so that one is mindful of how a global perspective can be translated towards application use cases, user cases in India. Get one's understanding around the nuances of and pricing tools, how XIR is different relative to yield in global context to local context, certain elements about how the operation framework functions, what are DBPs, what are settlement mechanism, where does the clearing agencies come in, so on, banking framework to begin with also, and any other home country accounting. These are just basis or knowledge that one needs to couple with the course curriculum. And I'm sure everyone will get a strong foundation to build a career on. It's an unbeatable combination. And why stop at that? This is something that I personally, not to DiCaprio's movie of Wall Street, I don't have any opinion on that, but on the concept of the hounds of the Debt Street or the Bond Street. Probably I should have used the example of James Bond. Sharp comes in at the right time, does his work, goes off and has a nice gin martini. I take a minute here. Have your horizons open if you wish to up the ladder, move from local to offshore, go from sell side to buy side, or come from buy side to sell side, roles in infrastructure players, so on. If one has a fintech, this market, as I probably said somewhere in between, is quite OTC oriented, at least in Indian context and many other world, many other parts of the world. It's quite intensive in client engagement. So there are a lot of things that can be digitized. Fintechs can come up and create a lot of easiness of how to run few things that we have been used to, and entrepreneurship. So there's a lot of possibilities to even take on entrepreneurship. With that, I close my piece. I thank you all for listening patiently. I say I'm indebted to debt, markets for life. Thank you all. Over to you, Raj.
Yeah, thank you, Jayan, for that very insightful presentation, and you know, and also equally comprehensive as well. I think I should compliment you for the sheer breadth that you covered within this short span of time, and covered all aspects of debt capital markets and the opportunities that for furthering one's career that DCM markets give. We have quite a bit of curious questions triggered by your presentations. So let me, before I begin the question and answer session, let me just remind others that you can still submit questions through the Q&A link at the bottom of the screen, and we will be monitoring that screen and passing on the questions for Jayan to answer. And Jayan will try to answer as many as possible within the time permitted. So over to you, Jayan. So we will quickly go to the question and answer session and trigger the questions. So here's question number one to you, Jayan. I think the first part is basically a little bit of macro, in the sense that, the shallowness of the debt market. And this has, I think, come about from various quarters of the audience today, is why is the debt market in India still underdeveloped? The level of transparency is still not there. And retail investors are still confused, unlike an equity market. to gather information as well as collect information and source deals for themselves. So there is a great degree of, I would say, opacity in a market that is that has so much of that is brimming with so much of potential. So what do you think, and what's your thoughts on that?
Thank you, Raj, and thank you to the participant for putting that question forward. The shallowness or development of our market is a necessary cause of concern, if I may were to say so. But let me first give some brighter side of the equation. I think on primary volumes of debt market, India is far many best in class Asian countries in terms of primary volumes of those debt market. I tend to believe that debt market typically has remained largely institutional oriented more than the retail oriented. I'm not saying that retail are not part of, welcome, but retail orientation is either indirectly entered through or arrived through the mutual fund segment or to the fund management segment. But again, coming back to the shallowness, there are various parts that we, many of our friends in the debt industry or debt market business were discussing India at Crossroads 20 years back are still discussing the growth of debt markets or what the debt markets need to do to take it forward. Unfortunately, I can get into it and I probably will forget the time commitment or time that I'll go on it. But so some parts are good in terms of development. There is shallowness. And that actually is an opportunity for a lot of us. When markets become pretty transparent, opaque, everybody gets it on the screen, then, you know, many of our professional careers do get reskilled or do require to be reskilled. And I might take that a moment when, you know, if one reflects back in 99, 2000, when euro as a single currency was introduced, there were, before euro as a single currency, there were so many traders on FX markets or currency markets that were trading a Deutsche Mark or were trading other country currencies, but suddenly when euro became a single currency zone, a lot of those roles were kind of folded up and they had to merge into a single currency, but not to scare away anyone on that front. Opaqueness in the debt market is what the regulators, I'm sure, acutely aware of. And as we see variety of regulations coming in, is in the right direction. Also the fact that IBC, while has come only 3-4 years old, it's 3-4 years old, it needs stabilization. So opening up of market components to certain unsuspecting retail investors before time is again a recipe of, recipe to disaster. And we've seen that in past as well, in variety of other markets. Things, when they need to be opened up for retail, they need to be opened up and they will come and flock. So if I were to take an example of InvIT or a REIT, InvIT and a REIT in other construct was always a private market play. And when regulations came in and they became open for retail or, you know, slightly a base minimum ticket of 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs or whatever it has been defined as, and market opens up and market really takes off. So we always have frustrations as to why has market not developed in advance. I have frustrations of why did credit derivatives market in India not take off. But I can leave it to other. So some components are well entrenched and they will provide a journey for taking away the shallowness. And it's an evolving country, evolving market. It gives you, all of you, a chance to be part of the journey to see the evolution through in your own way of bringing it into the country or into the market ecosystem.
Yeah, thanks Jen for that answer. So there are a lot of other questions that are coming in. So there's one interesting question here in terms of, if somebody is, having experience in equities, can one transition to debt market? If so, what would be the skills required on that? Would you like to answer that? How does one do a career pivot into debt market from an equities?
Finally, a debt or equity sits on a balance sheet of a corporate. As long as and as you are able to get that link created or in your mind set in, whether one is reading an equity research report or credit research report, a lot of things are common. reading a corporate balance sheet is similarly. However, there will be certain nuances. Instead of focusing on EPS, one may focus on DSCR, one may focus on debt EBITDA, and so on. So the roles that can open up can come in from that type of fundamental skills or technical skills of that one is gathered. Roles of fundamental skills may also open up for you if you have investor contact that can hold you from moving from one side to the other side. Other than that, of course, be up to speed with the regulations, by which the players have to play, by which the markets have to function. So those are some things which are not taught in any business school. So you are as good or as open to learning than as any other newcomer or fresher. So it's open to everybody. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Jain. Somebody is an entry-level job for a CFA charter holder in sell side or buy side, is there some kind of a specification in terms of what is a level that one can aspire in these as an entrant for a CFA charter holder?
A new entrant in a CFA charter holder could be a credit analyst, could be a fixed income analyst, macro analyst, could be any of the analyst role, could be in a sales support role. Now, even a sales franchise, now analyst role could be sitting in a buy side, could be sitting on a sell side. Sales support could be sitting on a buy side industry or a brokerage industry where you are given certain client segment to, shadow a senior sales guy. And then over a few months of learning, you take over. And my first job description for the first 1 month was marketing of nuclear power corporation bonds, which was 1995 June. 7th or 8th day into my role, I was handed over the information memorandum of a private placement document of bonds. And that was one. Other, I was handed over go into the yellow pages of then what was available and looked at all the cooperative banks that time and opened up the cooperative bank list and went on to EPFO office. So another senior colleague got a list of provident fund. So that was a journey in 95 for me. So I can say the journey today is far faster, far easier for newcomers now. It can be in a buy side, it can be a sell side, it could be an analyst role, it could be a sales support, and it can start wherever.
Yeah, thanks, Jain. Now, there is again another question on a pivot. I think a lot of people wanting to switch into debt based on your presentation and the questions that I can make out. How to build a profile to move from a credit analyst in a rating agency to a debt analyst role or a portfolio manager on the buy side, like if a fund manager or, on the AMC or any other portfolio manager kind of a company or a PE? Any additional skill sets that you think are required for that kind of a switch?
More than a skill set is probably to track the markets, what's happening on the credit spreads, what's happening on the new issues, how are the secondaries happening, how's the government securities going, yield curve shifting in a short time window of a day over day or a week over week, how are the industry benchmarks performing. As I addressed earlier for another question, get up to speed on the regulation. And in my own journey and my own hiring process that I had the need and I was given the task in different places, rating agency colleagues, I have seen many of them come in my team as well and as peers, as colleagues, and have formed sharp careers in senior fund managers as a credit desk or credit funds, and quite a few of them are there in the industry already. One key thing apart from knowing all this is use the network of CFA, use the LinkedIn professional network, reach out, doors will start opening. Raj, over to you.
Yeah. So, in terms of, from a career in debt capital markets, can a person independently work on debt raising for the clients? Is there a market for such freelance work? And what about the potential in debt syndication? I think these are two questions that I've clubbed.
Yes, there are freelancing friends in the freelancing community who have taken freelancing activity. It will require a certain element of connection into the both sides of the equation, the borrower side of the equation, as well as the lender or the investor side of the equation. So whether you as an individual have those connections or you partner up through referral arrangements with some other consulting firms or other brokerage firms, bring your skill sets of bringing those to the table, analyzing the balance sheet of people who might needing money, and you can start building on it. There's no stopping. There are many of single man shops in the industry, helping mid-sized, small-sized corporates to crossover, helping them build up a working capital model for taking into the banking community or NBFC community, helping them build up projections models, putting it together, take them to the potential lender, potential financer. If you go with something which you have prepared, which you have, but spend time understanding your case before you present it to your potential lender or potential financer. Spend time. Over to you, Raj. I think.
Yeah, then there is one interesting question. We just have, I think, two questions to take. One question is on, somebody who works as a research analyst for an offshore high-yielding fund, and they are fully interested, integrated in the research process, but they find themselves lacking with respect to helping portfolio managers beyond the fundamental research. This leaves them quite unsatisfied and look at what more they can add value. So that's basically the question. And how do we? I think the other thing is in terms of sourcing data and adding value on the debt, whereas equity, there's quite a bit of information available.
Let me try and give us some elements of that. Anybody on the buy side looking to extract value from a independent body like yours will like to hear not only on a fundamental, but also on more tactical approaches that's under play in the economy or in their specific market components, whether they are in the credit function or credit asset class, or they're specifically in specific countries. So all those, I think, start building up a commentary piece on what's happening at the marketplace. You yourself will have to actually get access to some of those pieces directly, indirectly. NSDL, NSE, BSE, their debt component, at least when I speak about India, they do put out a lot of information on day-to-day basis. New issue information is available on day-to-day basis. They are, as Raj, you also pointed earlier, there's a lot of data coming out, and more data will keep coming out. But someone requires to pull it together and put it as information rather than data and share it across to their target segment and continue to drill on value for them. Once you start drilling value beyond macro piece, I'm sure they will be open to conversations. Yeah, Raj.
Yeah, one final question. I'm sure that some of the audience questions are still left unanswered, but due to paucity of time, we can't do it. But one last question, this is on, technical side, what are the technical softwares typically used in the debt markets currently? And what would you recommend people from non-tech background?
Good question. That question actually gets me thinking as well. On the technical side, I've seen technical things happening on the rates front. I myself not done a technical course. I will not be in a position to answer more details on it. But I've seen my different colleagues working on rate side of the technicals, basically on the yield curve side, on the FX side. There are interlinkages between FX and rates, so that comes in handy. Somewhere it crosses into the credit spreads as well. Other than that, correlation between FX between different country to local country, and including interest rate differentials going on between sophisticated markets like yen market or Aussie dollar market, of course, and euro market to Indian market. There are certain technicals they are working on, but it's still nascent. So there's a lot more to come, which is the positive side of the equation.
Yeah, I can try and take it offline. Yeah, thanks, Jayan. With that, we have run out of time. I'm sorry, but yeah, excellent insights from you. Thank you so much for sharing the insights with us. As a reminder to our listeners, please do complete the evaluation survey that that appeared on your screen at the end of the session. CFA Institute and CFA Society India members may claim professional learning credit by logging in their online professional learning track tool. We also have upcoming webinars coming in. Do register if you have not done it already. That's on 22nd October 2020. We have between 5:30 to 6:30 p.m. Practitioners Insight Portfolio Management with Multicaps. The speaker is Atul Bhole. We also have ethics and decision-making interesting panel, the speaker being Alan Locke on 16th of October. This is also part of the Global Ethics Day celebrations that CFA Society India is doing. So these are the two upcoming webinars that you might be interested in and you would like to register for. With that, over to you, Harshad.
Copyright 2020. All rights reserved. This program is designed to give accurate and authoritative information in regards to the subject matter covered. It is distributed with the understanding that CFA Institute is not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, tax, investment, or other expert advice. If legal advice or other expert assistance is required, the services of a competent professional should be sought.